I don't know if you want to give any general commentary, but I'm about to take you through some quick side effects of androgen deprivation therapy when you're ready. Do you want to just do that?
Well, if we hadn't covered the exercise, I'd start right there. But I think we covered that nicely. So jump right in.
Yeah. So just keep in mind that if you put a checklist of every single side effect you can experience on hormone therapy, the only thing that will cover most of the boxes, most of the checks on that list will be exercise, right? Whether it's cancer-related fatigue, whether it's building up muscle. Because remember, exercise is not just aerobic. It's also resistance. It's also flexibility. I always hear from the one naysayer every year that says, well, I'm not in a position to do all those exercises. I don't even care if it's somebody wading in a pool or walking in waist-high water or just doing exercises within the pool and not moving. The body was meant to move and to change position every once in a while. Otherwise, it's a use it or lose it machinery. It really is. And so is the brain. quickly on your comment on anemia and hormone therapy.
It's usually mild. The anemia of low testosterone doesn't usually translate into the shortness of breath of severe anemias. When people say, I feel tired, is it because of this mild anemia that the testosterone has caused, low testosterone has caused? No, generally not. Usually it's a lack of exercise, loss of muscle that is causing the fatigue, not the anemia. So it's something though to be aware of, because I do have patients who go to their family doctor who says, oh my God, you're anemic, I'm gonna give you iron. And they're not iron deficient. They just have developed a blood count that's similar to that of a woman. Because they don't have testosterone.
And what about in terms of the weight gain? I mean, there's been lots of talk that some people experience extreme weight gain, some people experience minimal weight gain, but how about androgen deprivation therapy and weight gain?
It's a big deal. If muscle mass goes down, your metabolic rate drops. All you have to do is stay on the same diet that you ate for the last 20 years and you're getting too many calories. It's got to go somewhere. Usually goes right to the tummy. If there isn't a very, you know, targeted and thoughtful approach to eating, most men are going to gain weight, and it's much easier to keep it off than to get it off later. So people that are starting hormone therapy need to be thinking about their diet. How am I going to cut back on my calories?
Well said, well said. How about fatigue? I read this more than any other question from the patient submissions. I feel tired. I have no energy.
Well, you know that and if we talk about exercise all this whole time, it'll be useful for our patients. There are literal randomized studies looking at the degree of fatigue in people that do weight training and those that just do a normal lifestyle. And it's like night and day. And I see it in the clinic. Before we knew that exercise could get rid of this fatigue that is so prevalent in men on Lupron and other agents, we would warn them. We're going to give you a Lupron. We're so sorry. You're going to feel like a limp dish rag and you're going to drag in here. But we're saving your life, so no choice. And then later through the years, it became apparent that the men that would do regular focused weight training, keep their muscles up, feel pretty darn normal. I mean, it's like unbelievable difference. So that's the answer to fatigue.
JAMA Oncology a few years ago, one of the largest reviews, I had to review it because every month I review a different paper for doctors for the past 20 years when they get credit. So the one I had to review last year was one of the most comprehensive reviews of people going through cancer treatment and all the pharmacologic agents that could help combat fatigue and all the supplements. And then here, the conclusion was basically this. If you look at the JAMA Oncology article that looked at cancer-related fatigue, the meta-analysis, it said, we have nothing better than exercise in clinical study. Have a nice day. That was the whole thing. All right. So what about hot flashes? And there was a lot of questions on using estrogen for hot flashes. As you know, 10, 20 years ago, there were all these drugs for hot flashes and they all came with these catches. And so what are people going to do about hot flashes today?
A lot of men that I talk to that have hot flashes, a lot of them are a little hesitant to take any more medicines. They're already on a lot of medicines. And many of them just suck it up and just live with them. I don't hesitate to provide some pharmaceuticals. You mentioned estrogen, which is clearly the best way to treat hot flashes. In the old days, we used to give an injection of progesterone, and that became a little more problematic when it was realized that that can be converted into testosterone. So We don't do that quite as liberally as we would in the past, because progesterone also works. Estrogen has to be given in a patch, because the oral forms cause blood clots, but the patches are safe. And they're very effective. If people are a little nervous about estrogen, you mentioned it, I think, when you were talking to Tia about things like venlafaxine, which is a mild antidepressant, gabapentin, which is used for nerve pain and seizures and whatnot. They're not universally effective, but some people, they work really well. You're probably aware that that acupuncture can help hot flashes. Have you used that in any of your patients?
Yeah. So acupuncture, well, the data is really coming out now. So we're instructing other physicians and healthcare professionals to really start considering that data, because it used to be 1-2 studies and now it's 10, 11. And now these are very small studies, but they've had a now comparison in New York and other places to sham acupuncture. So they actually do have a placebo group and they're still seeing a potential benefit. And, you know, you can go once a week. Some people go twice a week. It also helps. It can help with mood. It can help with pain. It can help with a lot of other things. So to find a qualified acupuncturist in your area, or even acupressure for hot flashes, the initial investment is very small and the potential payoff to reduce hot flashes is massive, right? It's also being studied in your area in chemotherapy-induced peripheral neuropathy, or CIPN. So the multiple benefits of acupuncture, I get letters all the time. I talk to people all the time about this who are going for it, and they're either getting little or they're getting a lot, but they're getting something. So I'm glad you mentioned that, because I haven't even thought about that for a long time. So the answer is yes. That's a great thing to potentially consider. Where I'm not seeing a lot of help is the old days. A lot of people would recommend supplements for hot flashes. And unless there's a major catch, like someone's contaminated with estrogen or something, I haven't seen much beyond a placebo. Although I'm still a traditionalist, I still think organic ground flaxseed helps a little bit. That was a Mayo Clinic study. It had a large impact. They say it statistically didn't beat placebo, but clinically you could argue that it did help a lot of people. And what I like about this is it costs pennies. You use 2 tablespoons and it's loaded with fiber. And what you always hear, whether it's patients or someone in the public, what you'll always hear is that if it works or it didn't work, someone will go, "Well, God, I'm regular again. Thank you." So, you know, it's first do no harm, right? You still get a potential benefit, even if you don't get the benefit you were looking for. And some people get both.